Hey, everybody, check it out. I got a theme song.
The Ryan Stick Show.
Everybody, this is crazy. This is great. Okay, so we're having a little bit of connection issues, but that's okay. But the show will go on. In the meantime, Jeff is our special guest today, and as we connect with him, I'm going to show you a little bit about why my entire life I've been a devoted fan to this gentleman's voice and his musical skill. All right, check this out. Here's a little bit of stuff that you know and I know, and we'll be back with Jeff in just a second.
Life is like a hurricane here in Duckburg. Race cars, lasers, aeroplanes. It's a duck blur. Might solve a mystery.
If you're living in a bubble and you haven't got a care,
hey, get out of there! Where do you think you're going?
Pizza to go!
Well, you're gonna be in trouble, cause we're gonna steal your air. Cause what you got is what we need, and all we do is dirty deeds. We're the Spaceballs! We're the Spaceballs!
All right, so now you see, and now I'm reminding you all why you love Jeff. Right now, what we're doing is we're going to be trying to connect with him through a different method because, frankly, the regular method is not working, so we're going to be very creative. We're going to be using technology. Hey, Jeff, you still there, buddy? All right, cool, man. All right, so I'm going to connect it. You're going to hear Jeff right now. Jeff, say hello. Let's hear your beautiful talking voice. We're used to a beautiful singing voice.
Hey, man, how's everybody doing out there?
Oh, it's great. Okay, and now we're going to connect the screen. You see, this is why I'm so glad that I'm kind of like, not tech swabby, but kind of like a little Rico swabby when it comes to technology. I can kind of like, you know, feel my way around things when things go terribly wrong. And that's exactly what we're going to do right now. And this has never been attempted before, ladies and gentlemen, but we will try it out. Be seeing my Facebook. Let's see if this works. Okay, and in our messages, are we okay? Can I see it? I don't think I can see it. Okay, no, not happening. So might have to just do audio, video, dude. I can hear you. I'm just trying to figure out how to see. But as I'm trying to figure this out, Jeff, thank you very much for coming on the show. Of course. That's amazing of you to do. But at the same time, you know, we all know what you accomplished, but how does one start in the how does one pick up singing? I mean, you know, I carry that you're kind of a naturally gifted type of dude, but at the same time, that's a skill. When I hear those songs, I hear decades of experience to bring it to the maximum level that we all appreciated. How did you start singing, dude?
I started after I saw the Beatles on Ed Sullivan.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, I said what I want to do. And I was not time.
Oh, yeah?
And, just blown away by seeing how the crowd reacted, how I reacted.
Of course.
And from that point, it was music, 100%. I just went, that's what I'm doing with my life. And I got a guitar, and I practiced every day. And by the time I was 11,
I did it. Sorry. This was a big day for the beef. Please continue. Now everybody can see you.
I mean, literally, it was like schoolwork. Sorry, doesn't interest me. Music. My dad was so frustrated with me. He said, well, what am I going to do with you? I said, well, send me to music school and you'll see. I'll get good grades.
Yeah.
And I did. Peabody Conservatory in Maryland. And I started out in the third grade. I only went for 3 years, but I got straight A's.
Yeah.
And my dad, I guess music is your calling. And literally, I mean, I made it through high school, but beyond that, I didn't really go to school, just high school. And then I was playing music for 16 years, six nights a week in Maryland. That was a good club scene back then.
Oh, yeah?
I started really young. I was playing at 14, six nights a week. And my dad used to have to come in the club with us because we were too young.
Okay.
He got to hang out every night. That was good for him, you know?
Wow, that is an amazing amount of experience. Like, I've been playing since I was 15 and 16, but I got to tell you, Jeff, like, I sucked. Like, I was pretty bad. But if I was playing six nights a week, perhaps maybe I would be the vocal powerhouse of both music and sound as you are. Okay, so that's amazing that you started out that early. But, you know, before you became the definitive voice of the Disney Afternoon, you put out some albums. And I heard through a little birdie in another interview you did that you've had a working relationship with Quincy Jones. You worked with Mel Brooks. How the hell does all this happen exactly? Let's start with Quincy Jones.
I have to give my dad credit for this. My dad was a big supporter of my music once he found out, you know, that's what I was interested in.
Okay.
And he became the leader of my band.
Yeah.
And one night, my dad was always saying, you're going to sponsor your sister's softball team. You're going to, you know, invest in your brother's Boy Scout thing. And I'd be like, what? So this particular up, and he says, give me $15. I entered you in a songwriting competition. I said, oh, Dad, please. But I gave him the $15.
Okay.
And he had made a song that, because I was interested in recording, so I was doing some recordings back then. I would go into the studio with my own money and some musicians, and we would record my original songs. Anyway, my dad decided to enter me in the American Song Festival, and that was in 1980.
Wow.
And I won the damn thing. I couldn't believe it. I was just like, what? So part of the prize, not only did they give me a check for $10,000,
okay,
I got to come to
$10,000.
Yeah, that was a nice prize. I remember that. So when I came to LA in 1980,
yeah,
I just came here, got the $10,000, went home and thought, cool. And then I entered again for another couple years. And then the next time I entered, I won for best vocalist, which was another $10,000 prize and another trip to LA. So this time in LA in 1981, I decided, you know, I need to make this trip worthwhile. So I met with a few publishers, and they also were the judges of the contest too, these publishers. I remember meeting with the Gordy's family from Motown and stuff. And so when I went home, I didn't really think about it. I just met with them. I didn't hear anything. But I happened to meet with this woman who knew David Foster's sister. James Foster was her name. And she worked for Quincy Jones. So the song that won the competition the year before, they had placed with Smokey Robinson.
Really?
And Quincy got to hear the song, and then they said, do you have any other material? And I said, yeah. So I sent them 14 songs, and because I had been recording, and they said, wow, you know, how would you like to come to LA and meet with Quincy? He's interested in signing you to a publishing deal. I didn't even know what a publishing deal was, to be honest with you. But I came to LA. I got to meet with Quincy, which was unbelievable. You know, you can imagine.
Yeah.
I was like, this is ridiculous. And I said, you know, I'd love to do it. So he said, okay, I'll be in touch. Well, 6 months later, I got a phone call, and it was Quincy. I was rehearsing, and the guy said, "Hey, Jeff, you got a phone call." I said, "Well, just tell him I'll call him back because we're rehearsing." I think you might want to take this one. It's the guy says he's Quincy Jones, and I'm like, "Yeah, right." But I get on the phone, and it was he said, "This is Q," and I said, "Q," and he goes, "Quincy Jones." So I was like, "Wow." I said, "Are you serious?" He said, "Yeah." He said, "I like your material. I met with you 6 months ago. How'd you like to move to LA and write some songs for my company?"
I said, amazing, send me on my way.
So he sent me a contract, and I didn't even have an attorney at the time, but my dad helped me find an attorney that was out of New York. And the attorney from New York said, "No, you're not signing this contract. This is horrible." I said, "No, you don't understand. I'd go for free." So the contract says I'm moving to LA. So the guy says, "All right, give me a minute. Let me talk to them and see what I can do." Well, he didn't change the money at all. He just changed the length of the contract.
Okay.
So instead of a 7-year contract, it was a 3-year contract. Now, at the time, I didn't realize what that meant. All I knew was I was still moving to L.A. Well, when I got to L.A. and I signed with Quincy, I got 39 cuts in the first 2 years that I was with Quincy.
Wow.
39 recorded and placed by really famous artists like George Benson, Al Jarreau, Kenny Loggins, Gladys Knight. You know, and I was just like, "Man, this is easy. I love this." Well, 3 years I had recouped with Quincy. And I was getting offers from all these other companies to sign with them, but I wanted to stay with Quincy. But Quincy actually advised me. He said, "Well, this is your chance to cash in on your success. So take the money and run. I'll still be here." And I was like, "Well, but I want to stay with you." Well, it turned out Quincy Jones's company went out of business after a couple years. So I went with MCA, I went with BMG, I went with Sony. I was signed to 7 different publishers over a 15-year. But that's how it all started.
That's amazing, man. Okay, so, you know, I was re-listening to these epic songs and doing some research on them. I see that there was one composer of DuckTales and Rescue Rangers, and then another one for Darkwing Duck. But still, I always felt like all three songs belong to the same family, the same Disney afternoon, if you will. And it turns out the link is you. And as I was doing all this research on you before I reached out, I was kind of like, wait a second, the same guy who sang DuckTales sang Rescue Rangers too, and then, you know, almost dropped my laptop, and Darkwing Duck. And then I do more research, and he co-wrote the song for Spaceballs. It's just like some people in their lives can have one touch of greatness, but you've touched it all, and it's quite amazing. How did you become part of the Disney family there for a bit?
Well, that's a funny story. I as a singer, when I came to L.A.,
yeah,
I not only songs for Quest Music, Quincy's company. But because I sang my own demos, people started hiring me to sing their demos.
Okay.
And that was lucrative because there was Diane Warren, who's like the most famous songwriter in the world, started hiring me to sing all her songs. And it was awesome. I'd go to the studio, take a couple hours, sing her song, make some money, go off and write my own songs. So I met a lot of writers that way too. And this guy, Mark Muller, who was a successful songwriter. He had a few hits, one with Heart. And he wrote DuckTales and said, "Jeff, would you do me a favor and sing this cartoon theme for me?" And I said, "Yeah, sure, I'll come down." So I said, "Man, this is really catchy, DuckTales." You know, so Disney, they got the demo and he signed a contract that's the song they're going to use. And at the time, there were a lot of singing groups, the Jets and the DeBarge family. And there were some other successful family groups. And they tried all of them on DuckTales. And then Disney called me up and said, "Listen, we've spent a lot of time trying to find the right person to sing DuckTales, but we just can't get over your demo of DuckTales. We want to use you. So I said, yeah, okay. And at the time I was shopping a record deal, I wasn't sure that, should I sing a cartoon theme? Is that good? But, you know, as it turned out, I said, you know, I'll do it. I love it. So I went in and I cut it, and I didn't know it was going to be on every day after school for 10 years.
Yeah.
It was on net television, and it was like, boy, did I like going to the mailbox because I didn't really have time that it was going to be that lucrative or anything. I just did it because I love singing, and Mark ended up saying, man, they love it. This is going to be huge. And sure enough, it played every day. And then Mark wrote another one called Chippendales, and I sang the demo of that, and they didn't even bother putting anybody else. They just said, yeah, you can sing this one too. And the same thing happened with Darkwing Duck, and the same thing happened with, I did Gummy Bears and Winnie the Pooh too.
Okay.
There was an afternoon
show. Whoa, hang on. Sorry to interrupt you there. I was walking my dog last night, and I was like, man, I'm listening to these songs. I'm like, you know what's also an awesome song? Winnie the Pooh. Crap, it sucks that Jeff didn't sing Winnie the Pooh too, because then they could have added it in the reel. We could talk about it. The fact that you did sing Winnie the Pooh is blowing my effing mind right now. That
Winnie the Pooh's theme.
Yeah.
It was actually after DuckTales came on, they did a cartoon that had Winnie the Pooh first and then Gummy Bears.
Yeah.
So it's theme to those both shows, and it was called Unbearable Fun.
Okay.
And it went, it's unbearable fun.
Yeah.
It's weird. And the gummies rolled into one.
Yeah.
So it was like a theme for both of those shows.
Oh,
and
that came.
So that was pretty cool too.
Oh my God. That's so amazing. Okay. So with Gummy Bears and Winnie the Pooh, putting those together, that's great stuff, man, because it's like, it had this, all these songs had this energy to them. And I just a little something about Rescue Rangers. We don't have the same tech setup we usually have, everybody, because we had to make do. But I'm just so happy this is happening. I would have played it and would have asked you as we listen to listen to Rescue Rangers. But there's something about Rescue Rangers, just as a songwriter, if I could say anything about knowing my keys, which I barely do. Is there three modulations in the Rescue Ranger theme song? Like, do you go up three notes with each chorus? Okay.
It keeps it up, yes.
Oh my God, that is such... It's, guys, ladies and gentlemen out there, when you hear Rescue Rangers, it's not... Listen to it again. Every time they go to that chorus, and it's a genius edit, because I reheard the full-length version of Chippendale's Rescue Rangers that has all these parts, breakdowns, and a sax solo, and so much else going on that you don't even notice the modulations. But in the TV theme song version of it, it's incredible, the genius editing. Whoever edited it, kudos to you. Really showcased the power of your voice going from one key to the other to the other. Like, it must have been intense in the studio when you think you got it down, and it's like, no, it's not done yet.
I remember going, I'll try to hit this, and somehow I got it out, you know, it gets really high. That,
it's
just like, whoo!
Oh my God.
Yeah. That was challenging.
Which is your favorite of the three? I'm going to call it the big three, because those are the best Disney afternoon theme songs. If you don't count musics like Dark Gargoyles and stuff.
I would probably say DuckTales, because it's the most recognizable, and my granddaughter sings along with me now, so that's pretty cool.
Aw, okay.
She doesn't know DuckTales, but she knows DuckTales for some reason.
You know, Darkwing Duck, also, you know, you're a musician in your own right, you're a hired singer for this, but you got to admit, like, the bass lines in all three of these songs are fantastic, and the vibes and the grooves. And I could go on about Rescue Rangers all night, just based on how scary it starts. And then in the middle, it almost sounds like Van Halen, like, no case too big. All of a sudden, it's jump. And then the chorus is a celebration. But it all started with, like, lightning, fierce intensity and mystery. But then Darkwing Duck is this real smooth, like, smooth jam. you know, and I noticed like in your vocal ability, how soft your voice can be when you want it to be, almost like the purr of a kitten. Was the Darkwing Duck theme song, did they ask you to be like, all right, what you did last time, it's great, but this time, can you be a little bit more mysterious, or did it all come naturally to you?
No, exactly. I got guidance from the writers of the song. Can you be softer? Hmm. And that's something I in LA, singing so many demos and stuff and recording so much, because I did come from a live performance venue, and I always sang real loud, you know, because, you know, you just do that when you live perform.
Yeah.
But I learned soft singing from artists. Like I would see Kenny Loggins sing in the studio, and he was so soft, you know.
Yeah.
And I'd be like, wow, that's really good when he gets close to the mic and sings really soft. So I learned techniques from some of the great singers, you know, and I went, okay, I'm going to try to sing softer on this one because I think it fits the and stuff like that. So
I learned from Celine Dion that if you're going to be really loud, you should probably put the microphone away from your face.
Yeah.
Which is skills that some of my friends did not have when singing karaoke and singing Master of Puppets to terrible like elevator MIDI files and just screaming directly into the microphone to the right. Great disdain of every DJ that would have them. So these three songs happen. You also, let's get into your songwriting. Now you wrote a song that I didn't realize, like, you know, I've loved Spaceballs my whole life, and I love the song Spaceballs, but I would watch it in the movie, you know, and it was a great vibe. It's where Spaceball 1 is crashing, and they're evacuating everybody, and there's bears and a bunch of other stuff. And I listened to it fully, you know, and it's a beautiful, really cool song, but I see that you co-wrote it with Mel Brooks. Could you tell me the story of writing the Spaceball song?
That was pretty crazy. I mean, I get a phone call, and said, Jeff, could you write a song with Mel Brooks? I said, I mean, I was kind of feeling cocky. I said, I can write a song with anybody. So they said, okay, well, we're going to send you over to Paramount and you're going to meet Mel Brooks and try to write this song. He'll explain. So I had no idea. And I'm going to pick up my guitar because I want to tell you how this happened.
Please.
One second.
He's picking up his guitar, ladies and gentlemen. This is the best day
I'm
ever.
Waiting. Brooks to come into the room, and I have no idea what he wants me to write, but he walks in the room. He was the coolest guy.
Yeah.
You can't help but laugh at him because he's in the best mood. He's a funny guy, and everything he says is funny. So you're laughing like when he walks in the room, he's just that kind of person. You know?
Yeah.
And I've always liked Mel Brooks, so it was kind of cool that, you know, it was not just kind of cool. I was like in heaven. So I walk in and he says to me, if you're living in the bubble and you haven't got a care. And I was like, what? And he said, lyrics to my song I want you to write. It's called Spaceballs. And you can imagine I'm going to write a song called Spaceballs. Are you kidding me? But I literally played an A chord on the guitar. And I said, if you're living in a bubble and you haven't got a care. And he went, I love that. Just line. So I was like, great. And then he tells me the next line. And I just went, when you haven't got a care. You know, I forget the lyric right now.
Yeah.
And so we wrote the song together. He would feed me the lyric. And he said, well, what do you got for the chorus? And I went, I think you can go, Spaceballs, pop out. And he was like, I love that. So it was just, it literally happened in like 10 minutes.
Oh, dude. So
we just, he said he wanted something big with a horn line. And so I was like, da 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 da, Spaceballs. So the funny thing is to me, he said to me, we need to get a rock singer. Who do you suggest? And I said, well, David Lee Roth would be kind of cool. You know, Spaceballs. You know,
yeah.
That would be kind of cool. It's all right. We're going to see what we can do. And I said, you know, if you can't get them, maybe Van Halen with Sammy Hagar would do it. And, you know, there was a few other suggestions. So they called me and said, we got it. We got the Spinners. And I was like, the Spinners? I was blown away. I couldn't believe it. But they were so professional when they came into the studio.
Yeah.
They were dressed in suits, and the guy nailed it. I mean, the lead singer for the Spinners was a great singer. He just sang it, and I just watched him sing it and was like, oh, my gosh, this is really good. He nailed it. And the guy, they hired Jelly Bean Benitez, who had just come off Madonna's hits, to produce it. I produced the demo, and they liked that, but they didn't, you know, I was still starting out, so I didn't get the job producing it, but that was cool. I mean, I was happy to get it, believe me.
Yeah.
That one song recouped my whole deal with Quincy Jones.
Oh,
even though I had tons of, that was a very good sync fee. I think Mel paid like $60,000 for the rights to use that song after I wrote it with him. And it was pretty crazy. I just was like, wow, this is amazing.
What did you think of Spaceballs, the movie?
Well, when I first saw it, you know, I was like, this is so funny. But my wife at the time went, and she was, that was the worst movie. I said, I thought, but she wasn't a big Mel Brooks fan. I am. So everything he does, I think, is funny. So I really liked it. I got to go to the premiere, and that was pretty cool. And, you know, it wasn't that big of a hit. It became more of a cult hit, kind of, you know?
Yeah. Oh, man, that's so amazing. We have so much love, by the way, for you. I just need to say, you can't see it right now, Jeff, but everybody is saying, like, oh, my God, you made my childhood. They're criticizing the new version of DuckTales because they like your version more. I got to say,
that was kind of disappointing. The writer called me and, you know, he said, there's no way they're going to change, you know, your iconic version.
Yeah.
And they did. Got an American Idol singer to sing it. I was happy for them. It just didn't matter. You know, it was cool that I got to do it the first time, but I've gotten a lot of emails from around the world telling me how disappointed they were with the new version, but they just didn't ask me to sing it again. What can I say?
You know what? I got to say, representing the audience that's watching right now, it's not just your singing voice. It's the fact that they kind of took DuckTales and they almost pushed it on fast forward. So all the natural grooves and feels are actually kind of gone, because maybe they were trying to do something a little bit more younger and in your face. But at the same time, as someone who's been playing punk music for 22 years, I'm kind of like, why is it so fast? And if I'm saying that must be pretty effed. That must be pretty effed up. So I'm trying not to swear here because my friend's kids might be watching this. Everybody, I know, Jeff, you can't see this right now, but you're getting so much love. Vincenzo is saying this is so sick.
Thank you very
much. Yeah. You know what, everybody, if you have a question for Jeff, start asking him now and I will make sure that they get through. He can't see them, but I can. Meanwhile, I got tons. You wrote a song for a James Bond film. How the heck does one write a song for a James Bond film? Timothy Dalton represent.
Yeah, that was cool. My manager, his name is Ken Kushnick. He managed me for a while.
Yeah.
And he was a music supervisor. And music supervisors, you know, they hear what movie's being done and they get in there and try to get the job to supervise the music for the movie.
Yeah.
So he got it with James Bond, and they said they're looking for a song for a fight scene. And I did this song called Dirty Love.
Yeah.
And they loved it. So I was hoping that I would get to sing it. And at the time, I was really excited because I thought this could be cool, because if I'm the artist in a James Bond movie, people are going to hear of me. And they ended up saying, well, we need somebody more famous. And so they said, we got a guy named Tim Feehan. And at the time, not anything against Tim Feehan, but I was like, well, I don't know who that is. That's not a guy, famous guy.
Yeah.
But he did heal, and I did not. So he got the job singing Dirty Love, and he did a good job. It was cool. I didn't have anything to do with producing it, but they did a nice job. And, you know, I wish Tim Feehan became kind of a successful artist. I've heard of him after that. But yeah, that was a cool thing to get a song in a James Bond movie, you know.
You wrote a song, you know, a lot of the cartoons you write songs for, well, have sung songs for, involved a lot of ducks having a lot of adventures. But you also wrote the song for Princess Guinevere and the Jewel Riders. And although I didn't watch the cartoon, I saw the I saw the advertisement for the toys constantly, and had the you know, the chorus in my head all the time. Princess Guinevere and the Jewel Riders. How was it writing that, you know, showing a softer side of Jeff?
Yeah, that was another job I got, and my manager said, would you like to do all the music for Princess Guinevere and the Jewel Riders, you know? And I was like, sure, why not? And I got to hire this girl singer who's great. Her name's Robin Kermsey.
Yeah.
Because the girls, they needed girl singers, obviously. So I wrote all for that. I think it was like 10 or 12 songs. And it was, you know, it did pretty well. And it was just a gig. I did produce all those songs. But in, you know, the theme was Princess Guinevere and the Jewel Riders.
Yeah.
So I just, how am I going to sing that? And it just came out, Princess Guinevere and the Jewel Riders.
You know? Yeah. So, oh, man, it was awesome. It's awesome. Like in the cartoon, you know, I'm like, I'm not going to buy these pony toys when I was a kid. Think back on it now, maybe I should have. But I was like, man, that's a that is a catchy riff. And sometimes thinking of something that catchy and thinking of something that lasts, it's not always easy. And then other times when you're with Mel Brooks, it comes very easy. But you mentioned something that I find very interesting, where you're like, I didn't produce that, or I did the demo, or someone else sang the stuff. What's it like to write a song that is that beloved, whether if it's in Spaceballs or somewhere else, where you kind of have to give it away, put it out into the world, and cross your fingers that the finished product is what your imagination had? Do you have like a way of detaching yourself to not, you know, feel like someone is dressing up your baby funny?
Right. Yeah. That was some adjusting, I must admit. I remember when I first got to LA and I would write a song.
Yeah.
And, you know, I feel that I'm an artist, even though I didn't have a deal. I'm still a singer who played his whole life. So I'm the artist in my mind when I'm writing a song.
Yeah.
And I would hear, I remember Quincy said, well, we got Lou Rawls cutting one of your songs. And I love Lou Rawls, don't get me wrong. But I heard the song and I'm like, wow, that is a stretch. You know, I didn't Lou Rawls doing that at all. But at the time I was happy to get the songs placed with, you know, artists that were happening and selling records, so I felt really blessed at the same time too. But yeah, there's been some disappointments when you create a song and you feel like you've got magic, and then the record came out and you're like, oh man, they didn't capture it, you know. But I was happy to get the cut, and I should be thankful. So it was just some adjustment, you know. I had a story. I wrote a song that Quincy called me and said, Michael Jackson's cutting your song tonight. Come down to the record plant.
Okay.
Now you can imagine that phone call. I was dancing in the kitchen going, this is unbelievable. And I wrote this song called Spare the Rod, Love the Child. So the message was, you know, don't beat your children, love your children. You know, I didn't believe in, you know, spare the rod, spoil the child. I didn't believe in that.
Okay.
So I get to the studio and Michael comes out, he's eating dinner. And I met Michael for the first time, really nice. And he said, I love your song, but I have good news and bad news. And so I said, well, give me the bad news first. And he said, well, I can't cut your song, Spare the Rod, Love the Child, because I just cut a song called Man in the Mirror.
Okay.
And even though songs don't sound the same, they look the same, which means they're both message songs.
Okay.
And one, changing the world by changing yourself, and mine was changing the world by not beating your children, love them. So he said, I can't do it. And I was obviously really disappointed. And he said, but the good news is Jermaine's brother's cutting it.
Okay.
And that's not the same as Michael cutting it.
No, it's not.
But Jermaine, in all fairness, did sell a million records on his album.
Okay.
And also Ronnie Millsap cut the song too.
Yeah.
So that still, I love the song. You know, sometimes we write songs and even though they were cut, I don't think the right artist did them. And now at my age, I'm thinking about redemoing some old songs because the songs still hold up. For sure. And maybe I can get them again, you know, this time around with the right artist. So I'm kind of doing that now. I'm bringing some old songs back, you know.
I think the world would be happy to hear them. We have a question from David here. He says, what's an OG cartoon song from your youth that you remember?
Oh, what does OG mean?
Just original. From back in your day when you were a kid, before you entertained us, what entertained you?
I loved Johnny Nash's Hercules. And then when I found out Johnny Nash sang I Can See Clearly Now, I was like, oh, man. So he did cartoons and he became famous. So maybe this won't be so bad, you know. But I liked, I loved all the theme songs. Not so much cartoons, but TV shows like the Beverly Hillbillies and, you know, MASH and all those TV shows. I loved the music. You know, I would know all. In fact, my band, we would always do as a break song a television show like the Flintstones. We would go we'll be right back, we're gonna take a little break, and then the next set we would do another theme song. So I like TV theme songs, you know.
My mom is saying yeah, she loved all those songs as well. I gotta say, when I was growing up, like you don't know what good is, you don't know what a golden age is, you don't know like when things are quite amazing until you take a step away and you're like, hey, wait a second. They had all these hit television shows in a row in a single afternoon. And they were all Disney, and just the quality of animation, storytelling, songs, all that was on this caliber that I found in the 1980s, despite the fact it made really cool toys in a story sense, did not have. But when I was listening to all the theme songs, I said to myself, wow, like, what did theme songs, were they ever this good before? And you mentioned the Flintstones, and I'm like, I think in the 1960s Hanna-Barbera had something to prove, because the Jetsons and the Flintstones are these amazing songs, right?
And yeah,
but then later on songs, I think cartoon songs have always been the greatest strength of a cartoon, whether if it's good or if it's bad. It's a melody that has to land in 20 seconds, and that must be a lot of pressure for a writer. Did you feel such pressure while writing the theme songs to the cartoons that you submitted to?
You know, I didn't focus on writing cartoon songs. I just, like I said, I sang them, and that's how I got the gig on DuckTales. And then my manager, you know, just for gigs would say, would you like to do the music for, you know, Princess Guinevere?
Yeah.
And you know, I didn't really try to write cartoon songs. So, no, I didn't feel any pressure from that. But I remember, you know, when Mark Muller wrote DuckTales and he wrote Chippendale's Rescue Rangers, I said, man, you really got a knack for this, because they're really good songs. Besides being cartoons, he wrote really good songs, you know, and you could tell his strength as a songwriter was really cool. That's not an easy song. Even now when I go to play it, I'm really good memory with chords, but I have to think about the chords, the DuckTales. It's not just two chords. It's like a lot of chords in it.
So much is going on. So much instrumentation. It's almost like a little pocket Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band going on in there. There's so much happening in a span of a few minutes. We have another question here from Shamar. He says, what was your inspiration behind the style of the Disney? What is your inspiration behind the style of the Disney afternoon shows? Well, as I could say, we can't say musically, but as a singer, Like, did you go in kind of like trying to sing with a smile? Because when I hear your voice, I hear you singing with a smile and swinging from a vine, oddly enough.
I do. People used to say you're always smiling when you're singing.
Yeah.
And I just have it fun, you know, it's fun to me. Thing. And so when you sing DuckTales, you can't help but smile because it's just fun, you know? So I think that's part of the reason they couldn't get past the demo, because I put the energy in it because I was having a great time doing it, you know, and those oohs, you know.
Please tell me,
in DuckTales, woo, and it was just fun to do it, you know. So, yeah, I didn't have a pressure. I just kind of went with, you know, singing from the heart. I'd kind of do that. I feel like as a singer, I don't really try to be emotional, but I think you have to live a little bit to have emotion in your voice. And because I hear singers, you know, I don't watch American Idol and The Voice, but there's some great singers. But I feel like sometimes, wow, they need to sing a little more and go through some life experiences before I'm going to feel it from them, you know? And that's one thing. I think I have tons of experience of singing, and I have some pain to draw on in my life. So you kind of get emotion from that. And I used to tell people that are going through some things, I said, it's okay. It's going to make you a better singer. You know?
I love it, man. That's awesome. Especially because you played a little bit and I almost crapped my pants. So that was fun, especially on the internet.
I can do a little bit. Life is like a hurricane here in Duckburg. Base cars, razors, airplanes. It's a Duckburg. Might solve a mystery. Or rewrite history. DuckTales, woo! Every day they're out there making DuckTales, woo!
Awesome. And life complete. Well, that was off my bucket list. Dude, was the woo always there? Was that something you kind of brought to it? Because nothing was happening there. Did
No, that was part of the song.
Oh, okay.
Know, adding... I mean, I had something to do with, you know, the arrangement of the harmonies and stuff, because I would suggest things. But, you know, the writer had most of the song, you know, he had it down. He would play it on the piano, and he's not a singer, but you could get the vibe from him doing it, you know.
Yeah. And I hear some, like, I don't know. Sorry about my mic wire. I don't know if they're minor notes or something like that, but just like when it goes into that kind of pre-chorus, or if you want to call it a bridge or something, like there's a stranger out to find you. And it's like, it feels different. It's like this song, they're little like pocket symphonies where this happens and this happens, and you can feel so much in a span of like 35 seconds. And that is an art in itself. And that doesn't just take the music, but it also takes the vocal performance too. So, you know, I've been wanting to tell you this my whole life, but good job, because I don't think anybody could have brought that energy in recent events that has proven the same thing, that nobody can quite sing the song like you. So, yeah, everybody
appreciate that.
Everybody was singing along too in text form too. We got Shamara that literally said the woo. I believe he texted that in time with us. Okay, so we've gone over so much stuff, but at the same time, let's touch a little bit more into your writing and film. There is a very specific scene in Honey, I Shrunk the Kids, in which the older sister makes cleaning very fun by singing and dancing to a mop. And there's a song called Turn It Up, and I believe that you were the composer behind said song. Can you tell me about writing that song and your connection between you and Rick Moranis? Because that's two for two, baby.
Well, I have no connection with Rick, but I love him. I'm a fan of his.
Okay.
But yeah, I was actually sad news I just got like 2 days ago. The artist that cut that song died.
Oh.
Nick Kamen.
Okay.
And I produced two songs on his album, One was Turn It Up, and another one was called Bring Me Your Love. Bring Me Your Love was number one in France and Germany and Italy. And Nick was like an artist that Madonna signed, handsome guy. He looked like Elvis Presley. And, you know, he had some success. And so that one of those songs that we produced, somehow my manager got to Honey, I Shrunk the Kids and said they're going to use that in the movie. So I was just like, wow, this is great. You know, that was just luck. You know, what can I say? They just liked the song. And I wrote it with a guy named Pat Dreamer. He actually did a lot of the track before I got involved. He sent me the track to write lyrics, and I thought it would be great for Nick Kamen. So I did the lyrics and backgrounds on his track, and they ended up, Nick loved it, and that was part of his album.
Oh, man, that's amazing. And, you know, like I said before, some people you have touched with greatness. You can, you know, you can do that one or two things, but your list of accomplishments, especially in the pop culture world, is astounding. I got everybody else, by the way, I can't keep Jeff here all night. So if you do have any more questions, please ask them and I will reiterate them and read them the best I can. But, you know,
can I tell you a story about another little thing I got to do?
Please
this
do.
This is off. But, I forgot that I did it actually.
Okay.
It's just such a small thing, but in the scene where, in Wayne's World, when they're singing the Queen song and driving in the Pinto,
yeah,
the radio call letters come on, and it's me going WPIG Aurora. So I was in Wayne's World for a half a second, and I always, because I forget sometimes. You know, I'm watching TV, and all of a sudden I'm like, wait a minute, that's me. I'm singing that, you know, and it happens a couple times. I was, you know, I'll be watching a movie or something, and then all of a sudden a song of mine, you know, it's kind of crazy.
Well, that's really good to do so many cool things that you literally forget. You know, I that happens to me all the time, but it's not because I do so many great things. It's because I probably suffered more head trauma than I'm willing to admit. Okay. So, being in Wayne's World, that's blowing my mind, dude, because Wayne's World was like my introduction into like rock and roll. Like being 9 years old, seeing two dudes having a live broadcast on the couch. It's pretty much me and my best friend Jay, whom we've worshipped Darkwing Duck, by the way. And you know, that show, you can't have the vibe of that show without that theme song. We just love the idea of a superhero being like shorter than his sidekick. We brought that into other projects that we did. Wayne's World, getting back to Wayne's World, was my introduction, just music and heavy metal and all this stuff. And it just opened up my world. So the fact that you're even connected to Wayne's World, I'm like, you could have said, yeah, I got coffee for somebody on one of the days on Wayne's World. I've been like, you got coffee for somebody? That's amazing. But just WPIG Aurora. Awesome, man. Is there any other kind of funny stuff that you didn't remember, but yet you are a part of it? Because
I remember this. This was one of the days that I couldn't forget. I got a call, and they said, Jeff, Mick Jagger's cutting a solo record, and your name came up to sing backgrounds on it. Are you interested? I'm like, of course.
Yeah.
And so I go to the record plant where Mick's recording. And I show up, and Mick himself comes up to me and says, hey, you're Jeff? And I go, yeah. And he goes, nice to meet you. The guitar player is still finishing up some stuff. Can I get you anything to drink? And I'm like, what? Like, this is just nuts. So we ordered dinner, and I'm sitting there watching the Lakers with Mick Jagger.
Okay.
And he doesn't understand basketball, but I'm explaining it to him, and he explained the game of cricket, which I'd heard of cricket, but I knew it was a little like baseball. And I got to spend a week in the studio with Mick Jagger, and he's the nicest person you ever met. I mean, he's so down to earth. I just would leave and just be like, this is nuts. Like, and I'm not the type of person. You know, back then we didn't have cell phones with cameras, or else I probably would have taken some pictures.
Yeah.
But I'm not going to bring a camera and ask Mick to take pictures back then. I was trying to be, you know, professional and he was really cool. He sent me a gold record and he sent me a Christmas card thanking me. And I framed it, of course, and I have his gold record on the wall. And it was called Wandering Spirit is the name of the record. And I did backgrounds on like 7 songs. We did hand claps, tambourines. And I mean, I've spent a lot of time with them. And then about a month or so later, I got a call to sing on a Brian Wilson project.
Oh, dude. And
so I'm in the studio with Brian Wilson, and it just so happened the producer, Don Was, producing the Rolling Stones.
Yeah.
And we were at the studio. He had 2 houses. The house above was his house, and then he had a studio house that was a studio. And I came to work on Brian Wilson's project, and Keith Richards and Mick were by the pool. And when I walked in, you know, Mick goes, "Hey, Jeff," and Brian goes, "Hey, Jeff." And I sat down with him, and I'm like by the pool with Keith Richards, Mick Jagger, and Brian Wilson. And I'm just going like, this is pretty nuts. Like, nobody's going to believe this. I have no record of it, but this happened to me. And I got to sing. Brian Wilson did a project called These Times Weren't Meant for Me. And we recreated some songs from Pet Sounds. So I recreated all his background vocals with some other singers. And Brian was real happy with it. And God, I was in the studio with these guys all at the same time. And
wow.
It was in 1994 because there was an earthquake that year. And Keith Richards was telling the story about how he woke up to get another beer out of the fridge, and the fridge started moving. So he said, "Enough beer." He's going back to bed. And I said, "Well, earthquake!" Like, we were laughing because he didn't know it was an earthquake. He just thought he had too much to drink. That was really funny to hear him tell that story. You would be laughing your ass off. You know, it was funny.
Oh my God, that's incredible. Yeah, especially I did. Sorry about that. It's an educated guess that Mick Jagger and Brian Wilson and Keith Richards would have been in the same place at some point, but it's a little bit when it's kind of like the $1 million quartet situation, and you know, you happen to be just hanging around, and especially to know them by name, like them to know you by name. Like, I would think I would die a happy man if Billy Joe Armstrong from Green Day, like, you know, said, "Oh, hey, Ryan," and been like, "Wow." You know, as opposed to saying, "Okay, can you make it out to Ryan?" That's R-Y-A-N. And yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, because Brian had just worked with me for the last couple days.
Yeah.
And Mick remembered that I just sang with him. So they actually knew me. And it was so bizarre. I called my parents. I said, "Mom, you won't believe that I just worked with Mick Jagger." And she goes, "Rick Jagger, who's that?" I go, "No, Jagger, Mom." And she said, "Oh, is that the guy with the big lips?" And I said, "Yeah." And she goes, "Oh, I never liked him." And I was like, "I'm gonna call somebody else and tell him, because I'm really excited right now and I don't want you to blow my vibe." So
yeah,
I called my brothers. And
what was everybody's probably like, "Get back to DuckTales." I'm like, no. What was Brian Wilson like at that point? Because he was, you know, for quite a few years, he was kind of elusive when it came to the public eye and stuff like that.
You think he's not there, but then he does something to surprise you and makes you know, oh my God, he's 100% there. I remember we were rehearsing because we did a gig at the House of Blues. And we did 3 songs. And so we were rehearsing those 3 songs. And we're doing California Girls. "Wish they all could be California girls," right? So we're singing. And he goes, "Jeff, I want you to sing this note." And he leaned back and he looked up at the sky and he kind of fell asleep. It was the weirdest thing. Like, everybody just looked at him.
Yeah.
And we thought, is he okay? I think he's asleep. Anyway, so his wife came and she rubbed his neck and, you know, she started kissing him a little bit and giving him comfort. And in about 10 minutes, he came to and went, "B flat. That's the note I want you to sing."
Like, oh, man.
Crazy, right? But, you know, he wrote me a check for singing that night. I shouldn't have cashed it, but you know, it was $250. And we were donating our time for our charity.
Okay.
So I didn't get paid. But he said, man, you've done so much work for me in the rehearsal and everything, because I was kind of helping the backgrounds get the, you know, parts together and stuff. And he was just real appreciative. And I remember a guy coming into the green room when we were getting ready to go on. And he says, Brian, oh, my God, I met you in England when you did Pet Sounds and the Beatles were there. And you know, Brian's looking at the guy and he goes, man, I don't remember what I had for breakfast this morning. So,
but he
thought that was really funny.
But he remembered your name poolside.
He did.
Okay, by the way, that's all kinds of nuts. Like, wow, that's just that's rock and roll royalty. And it just goes to show, like, there would be fascinating. Like, you know, I love the movie Almost Famous so much, where it's not just about the rock stars, it's about everybody else. And all these stories you're telling me would make a great story or a great book. I hope someday you would consider writing one, because you have your feet in so many worlds, you know, the film world, the cartoon world, the actual music world, the rock and roll world. You've sat poolside with rock and roll giants. I mean, this is all some pretty good book worthy stuff, Jeff.
Well, thanks, man. Yeah, I tend to, you know, you don't really realize it till someone like yourself is interested in hearing it. So I kind of work by myself, and, you know, I don't talk about myself all the time. Obviously, that's boring. But when somebody's interested and I tell them stories, they go, oh, my God, you know, you got to be kidding me. So it makes me feel like, wow, I guess I've done some cool stuff, you know. I think I have.
I think you have big time, and you have to understand the fact that, like, I think in North America, and I'm saying this because I went to Japan, it's interesting. They have their own pop culture in Japan, but the idea is make a new series and kind of move on. So when I went to Japan looking for Dragon Ball and Sailor Moon stuff, no new series were out at the time. So I couldn't find anything anywhere. And, you know, they had some shops just for tourists because they know jerks like me are going to look for it. But in general, they're not like, hey, remember the 90s? But in North America here, we're like, hey, remember the 90s, the 80s, the 70s, the 60s? Like, we're all about that. So right now, in strange times, we kind of look within ourselves to find things that bring us much joy. And a theme song to a cartoon show could be that thing. Now, the unique thing about that is you happen to have that power to give people that joy three times over, specifically in one area. And then we touched upon the Spaceballs thing and everything else. So, Jeff, I want you to know, on behalf of me, who is about 37, I want you to know that the joy and amusement that you have brought to endless people for just a gig you are doing, I hope you realize how it resonated with us and inspired us and just kind of convinced us to grow up to be artists and grow up to be musical artists ourselves. I mean, kids, we didn't get rock and roll right away. We got those cartoons. You saw the Beatles on Ed Sullivan. I watch DuckTales. So, you know, you are our Beatles somewhat. So I hope you realize that.
Thank you. That's a nice compliment. I appreciate that.
Okay. Shamar is saying, wow, Jeff, you've done so much. Congratulations on all your accomplishments. Shamar is a great guy. He was very excited that you were coming on the show, man. It's absolutely awesome. Jeff, where can people, you know what? First of all, I want you to have more photos of you rocking in your career, because I was doing some research trying to put stuff together and I'm like, I want more Jeff photos online. So the next time I could ever convince you to be on the show, I could show some of them and just highlight this incredible career and life you've had. But where can people, if they're fans of yours, kind of find you on social media? Do you have social media?
Well, my name is Jeff Pescetto, and I changed my band's name is Little Fish, because in Italian, Pescetto means little fish.
Yeah.
So on Instagram, Instagram. I'm Little Fish, lowercase dash, whatever you call it, in LA. Little Fish dash LA.
Okay.
And I usually, before the pandemic, I was posting where we're playing all the time. But it's been quite a while. We haven't played since March of last year. So we're starting to get some gigs coming up. My group's called Little Fish. And I do have a couple albums out, and they should be on Spotify. Little Fish, if it doesn't come up as Little, because there are some other Little Fishes, but mine has a little fish that my granddaughter grew, and Jeff Pescetto, my name is attached to
it. Is it a capital LA?
No.
All right.
All cool. Small K.
There you go. Okay. So we got it right there. Oh, I got to do one more thing. I'm just letting people know the, making sure that people, it engraves into people's heads because, you know, I'm just some jump asking questions, but there's a whole generation of people that adore your work and what you've done so far, and the work's not over yet. Jeff, before I let you go tonight, I would like to ask you, how is the last year? It shut everything down, but things are kind of turning the tide, and we're always going to remember 2021 as that year where it was kind of like, you know, that's kind of the way we'll tell our grandkids about this. What is next for you? What do you want to happen in 2022?
Well, I'm doing a new album, which I've been working on. Excited about that. It's not done yet, but I've got a lot of songs. I'm just picking and choosing which ones are going to go on the record.
Yeah.
I'm constantly working with different people producing songs. You know, we're in my studio right now, and that's what I do. You know, I make music, and even if I didn't get paid, that's what I'd be doing every day anyway, because that's who I am. I love creating music. So the pandemic, even though I haven't played live, I'm still so fortunate I get to create music in my studio, and that hasn't changed. I bought a lot of guitars this year.
Yeah.
I don't know if you can see them all. They're hanging on the walls.
That is an epic wall of guitars.
And, you know, I've just started using them all because each guitar creates a different vibe, you know? So I've been into playing a lot and getting my chops together. So when we do play live, just continue to create music, you know, and I'm kind of retired. It's weird when I'm 66 now.
You look good for 66, son. Damn.
Thanks, bro. I feel like music's kept me young because I'm not stressed. I just like when you enjoy what you do, and it's, you never have to work a day in your life. And I don't feel like I've worked very hard. I just have fun. This is the love of my life, is music. So that's about it. You know, I haven't really thought about what's next except tomorrow. You know, I live in today. I just had brothers pass away. Two of my brothers, one was 70 and one was 64. They both had heart attacks and died. And I'm thinking, man, that's just crazy for me. So I don't think about the future very much. I really live in the moment and just enjoy waking up. And I'm like, okay, I get another day. What am I going to do today? And I always live like that. And I don't know if it's right or wrong, but I feel like if you're living in the moment, you're not going to be sorry in the end. You're just going to appreciate every day. And I'm not thinking about the future, really.
Well, thank you very much for living in the moment with us tonight, Jeff. This has been absolutely awesome. And thank you for being so giving with your time, too. It's a strange time, and people need to find smiles, and I hope the audience tonight has found some smiles. Julia is saying that, or sorry, Julie is saying that if you ever happen to come to Montreal with music, dibs on being a shotgun for being the photographer. And Vincenzo, a young filmmaker who I'm sure got inspired by DuckTales as well, who is a great filmmaker and making stuff right now. He, I hope Vinny, I call him Vinny. I hope you had a great time tonight. And I hope everyone else has too, because this has been absolutely, exhilarating. And as much as I'm excited about DuckTales, I can't get that Brian Wilson and Mick Jagger and Keith Richards part in my head. I'm like, I don't even think people have ever even Photoshopped them, because they're always putting the Beatles and Beach Boys together, but you never would think the you know, Brian Wilson and the Rolling Stones. This has been absolutely awesome, man. Shamar says, thanks, Jeff. And I say thanks too. Jeff, stick around. We are going to be going off the air right now. Thanks everybody for watching Ryan Stick Show. This has been absolutely awesome. Have yourself.
Thank you,
man. Oh, sorry. Sorry. Interrupt it, the internet lag. Sorry about that. Do you have anything to say to the audience before we go?
Just appreciate you and thank you for listening, and, you know, stay healthy, stay safe.
Awesome.
And keep up the music.
Awesome. All right, everybody. It's been a week. See you next time. Bye.
The Ryan Stick Show.